My guest is a master clown who has been an unforgettable part of street performance, cabaret, festivals, and stage for over 30 years. He has been described as one of the most exciting and riveting performers of the clowning genre. Indeed, elements of his performances have been compared to the works of writer Samuel Beckett and legendary performer Marcel Marceau. And yet, many people would associate him with the man who sticks a Roman candle up his bottom and lights it to the sound of "There's no business like show business." He's often outrageous, provocative, manic, dangerous, and of course, funny. He is Chris Lynam. Chris, welcome.
Wow, it's what such an intro, a pleasure. Thank you.
No, thank you. It's such a pleasure having you here. Anyway, but for me on a personal level, it's particularly special because this is not the first time I'm meeting you. I met you, I actually had an intimate moment with you, shall I say.
Wow.
About 30 years ago, which you don't remember, but I remember well. It was at the Zap Club in Brighton. And I made the mistake, and thanks to you, I learned from that mistake, in that I sat at the front of the venue, and you dribbled chocolate on me.
Oof.
You stuck your hand down my shirt and you got a bra out. Not my bra, but you did. Actually, you took my shoe off, you took it away, and you never gave it back. I had to limp into the back of the stage at the end of the show and find it. And then, of course, he took all your clothes off. And,
goodness me. You must have been heckling me, because that's the way I treat hecklers.
I was terrified. I was terrified, but it was an amazing, amazing show. Wow. So I think, shall we get the firework up the bum out of the way first?
Mm.
Shall we start with that? Because
It's unfortunate that it's become my kind of trademark, and it's a kind of sensationalist bit. To tell you the truth, I don't think it's very funny, but it was the late Malcolm Hardy. I used to finish up my street show with a Roman candle, staying in the Victorian bloomers, and I'd say I'd finish up with a small fantasy and shoot it out like I was p***ing sparks. And then when I joined Greta Show on Legs, Malcolm said, "Well, why don't you stick it up your ass?" And I went, "Phew, no, Mal," because these are Chinese fireworks I was using at this time, and I knew that sometimes they thought they were bombs, not fountains. So I'd had a few accidents where my hand got blown up, and the thought of having my ass blow up, I was going, I don't think so.
But you did.
Anyway, yeah, it became a trademark piece. And like I said, it's a bit unfortunate because I'm remembered as that bloke who sticks a firework up his ass, as opposed to, you know, I'll do an hour and a half of funny stuff, and that's what people will remember. Just
well, that's definitely one of the things that people remember. But things people do remember other things, and I have over the years seen you doing other things, very very different things, and we'll get back to that. But I wanted to go back to perhaps the beginning of your career, which kind of started at the age of 14, 15, and that was in not in Africa.
Yeah, Zimbabwe. It was Rhodesia at that time.
So tell me about that. What makes a 14, 15-year-old boy?
Well, it was kind of chance. I worked in my school holidays, got a job at a Luna Park selling Cokes the first year when I was 13. And when I was 14, I just happened to be asking for a job at the same time that two guys from the RAF, the Royal Air Force, in their month holiday used to do a fakir act, Raja stuff, sticking nails up your nose, walking up ladders of razor blades and lying on beds of nails and blowing fire and stuff, and they needed an assistant, so I put my hand up for that, and they taught me those things. And then, so at 14, I was doing shows in the afternoon, the matinee kind of shows.
And you kind of knew that you enjoyed it so much that you sort of...
No, it was just a kind of job, rather than selling Cokes. I thought, well, you know, there wasn't much thought into it.
Right.
And then it was only when I decided to become a clown age 20 that I kind of remembered that stuff and went, oh yeah, well, you can blow fire, and you know, I still blow fire to this day to a comic effect, you know.
And when you say you decided to become a clown at the age of 20, how does one get up in the morning and decide to be a clown?
I don't know, it must be a kind of zing light, because it was literally that. I'm going to be a clown, I'm going to make people laugh, that's it. and started and pursuing that.
Was that in Zimbabwe? Were you
No,
here?
It was here. I was here.
So when...
I came here when I was 17 to Europe.
Okay. Mm. So what happened? What was the move like? Why did you... Was your family moving away from...
No. I'd already left home and had spent 2 years travelling in Africa and then went back to what was Rhodesia then. And two things happened in the space of a week. One, I got my call-up papers for the second time to go and join the army to fight for the War of Independence, which I was going, mm. But...
At what age was that?
17.
17. And you didn't want to do that?
No. And at that time, I'd, you couldn't get a job in Rhodesia at that time, except on the railways if you had long hair. And I think I had kind of this length hair. You know, it was the 60s. I was involved in the hippie kind of culture and atmosphere.
Actually, before you continue, your hair is also one of the things why people remember you, because you've got, you have amazing hair.
Yeah.
But also, I've never seen you like this before. Your hair normally stands.
Yes.
And that's definitely one of your...
Trademarks.
Yes. Yeah.
That's my costume. In fact, that's what I charge for. The show's free.
So, okay, so you didn't want to
join the army. And I'd got this job as an electricity meter reader, which I thought would be a great job because you get 2 weeks training and then put on a scooter and go around to all the... country houses and knock on the door to read the meters and,
right.
You know, who knows who would answer the door to. Anyway, on the second day, I lost the wig which I'd adorned to get this job because I couldn't get a job with long hair, so I'd got this short wig.
You actually did?
Yeah. And on the second day, I'd come out of work, it was November, and I'd come out of work after the first day and run around the corner and rip this wig off and shake my hair because, you know, it's searing heat there. It's 35 degrees and stuff. And to have your hair pinned up, and I had more hair then when I was younger. And anyway, on the second day, I lost the wig and showed up on the third day for... I lost the wig on the way home, having taken it off on the bus, and showed up the next morning with long hair, and the boss was... absolutely gobsmacked that he had been duped and told me, get out and get the haircut or don't come back, eh? So I went straight to Thomas Cook and what's the soonest, quickest you've got going to Europe? Because call up and couldn't work. And I had 4 days to get to Cape Town to get on a boat, a Castle Line boat to Southampton.
Wow. Wow. Yeah. So under these circumstances, you left Africa. But yeah. you still go back to Zimbabwe?
Yeah. And in fact, I bought a piece of rainforest about 35 years ago, and I spent a lot of time trying to restore that and look after it and built a 5-story log cabin for some ridiculous reason.
Which you're hoping to live in one day? Or?
No, the whole place is destroyed. They discovered gold in 2003, just off the property. Plus, prior to
that... They discovered gold?
Yeah.
In your property, though?
The whole area is devastated. The last piece of lowland rainforest and a whole big, beautiful national park is... The Chimani Manis are phenomenal.
Right.
All destroyed with gold panning. But also, just prior to that, Mugabe had requested that most white-owned farms and some black-owned farms were vacated for his uncles and aunts and friends and family and cronies.
Right.
All those farms got taken away, which is a bit unfortunate. So, yeah, that whole area is destroyed.
Mm. Okay, let's go back to you coming to the UK.
Europe, yeah.
You're a mime. You're a sort of classic mime artist to an extent.
No, I'm not trained in mime.
But you're not trained. So,
no.
But you were going to go to a very prestigious school and then it didn't happen.
Yeah, no, when I decided to become a clown, that's what I applied for. Lecoq School in Paris was the only place available. And I applied for and got one of the 80 places out of 3,000 applicants or something. But the demand for the first year's fees came at the same time as the acceptance, which I spent a month trying to gather together, 2,000 francs, I think it was, and couldn't. But and so I was determined to do it, so I just got out on the street and did some tumbling workshops at the Oval House in Kennington. At the Oval, yeah. And
so your training came from
that,
the street,
and from
really?
The street, yeah.
Are you sort of pleased in a way that you didn't get formal education?
I've seen quite a few people who've come out of Lecoq School, and yeah, there have been some inventive people, but you know, it's mostly that kind of how do you do it? Oh, God, you know,
right.
Where's the ball? So, and I spent 3 years learning how to move this invisible ball around, which I've developed my own character, which I would never have done to that extent. You know, the lunatic, I think, would have been squashed in that environment.
Right. So lunatic is one way of describing you, certainly a way that I've described you when I tried to tell people about your performance. How would you describe your, you know, you say you're not a trained clown as such, you don't come from a particular school of genre of clowning. How would you describe your performance?
I think it's, I do things to make myself laugh, really. You know, if other people enjoy it, that's great.
Absolutely. Chris, we're going to take a little break now, but okay. We'll come back.
I'll be here.
Welcome back to Extraordinary People with Chris Lynam. Chris, before the break, we touched upon the type of clown that you are. And you know, people who do describe you talk about this kind of mad, not really controllable to an extent.
Anarchist clown.
Anarchist
I like that title.
Clown.
Yeah.
I get the impression that in real life, if you can call it real life, you're probably very different. Would you say you are, or?
I think I'm just like a normal person, really. And being on stage is my holiday. You know,
right.
that's when you can be free to do all these little flights of fantasy.
So you actually, your job is your hobby to an extent.
Yeah.
Is it Gustave Flaubert who said, if you lead an ordinary life, you can preserve all this energy to be completely crazy on stage, and I guess a lot of performers perhaps are that. So. The other side of you, I suppose, I don't know if it's another side actually, but I was really, really surprised. A few years ago, I was personally recommended to go and see a show by the director of the Old Market Theatre in Brighton. And all he said to me is that you've got to see this show, Eric the Fred.
Ah.
I went with my son. I really didn't know anything about it. I just got, you know, he recommended it and I thought that was good enough. And then I saw you and I thought, that's this guy, you know, from so many years ago. But the show was so different.
Yes.
It was not the guy.
Have you got? Can you show pictures on this thing?
We definitely show a picture of it. Yes.
Eric the Fred is phenomenal. I mean, it was put together as my kind of attempt to be commercially successful, and so three of us got together and decided how to go about this, and we thought. White face would be good, silent, and don't go into the audience, because those are the three kind of things that promoters and bookers are fearful of about the Chris Lynam persona.
Right.
And so we thought, okay, let's try and not upset anyone and make a foolproof thing. And so, yeah.
I don't know about commercial, though. It was very, very artistic.
Yeah. But I think it is, for me, it's the most beautiful thing I've done. And the music is just, I was going to give up on it because it was quite difficult to sell. There's six of us. Although it's a one-man show, there's five technicians on it.
Right. Yes, because it does involve all these.
Yeah, and I'm working with film, working against myself with film and working with puppets, butterflies. I mean, you know, Chris Lynam working with butterflies.
Right.
It's not the same kind of thing, really, is it, as the fireworks guy? I think I was going to give it up, and then my friend Kevin Sargent called up and said, oh, I've just written the theme tune for Eric the Fred, and he played this piece of music, and it was just like, oh, God, there's no way I can give it up with that. And he developed and wrote the whole score for the piece, and it's really beautiful. I think I'd like to revive it, actually. If I was to recreate anything.
It was also very dark,
yeah.
And very poignant, very sad, and it was about a clown, and the clown takes tries to kill himself, kind of unsuccessfully. In fact, I have a quote from you. Well, I hope it's from you. I found it. And you said that it was that Eric the Fred is an attempt to be accepted as a performer who is still funny, but who isn't going to frighten the metaphorical horses. I know they're asking, what does the bloke who sticks a firework up his bum, I'm not allowed to say the other word, do for an encore? Well, this is it.
I didn't write that.
You didn't write it. No. Oh, well, someone quoted you, but it is beautiful. Mm. And do you kind of regard, or did you regard that performance as a sort of encore?
It was something I kind of wanted to do. So more classical clowning, get into that genre, because you know, I've only ever been the anarchist clown. No, that's not true. I've written quite a few different pieces and worked with a few different directors. You know, I've played Spike Jones in some piece, and I worked with Ken Campbell on quite a few different things. And well, I did The Warp, which was a 24-hour-long play. And in order to do that, you'd played 6 or 7 different characters. So, I've done bits of acting, but, you know, working with Campbell is working. He was another anarchist, really. No, not really an anarchist. He was quite an extraordinary man, a fabulous director. Wow.
Do you have any kind of plans to take your performance elsewhere completely, or are you happy to kind of go with the flow, as it were, I suppose?
Yeah, I mean, it's been quite nice. I've really enjoyed having a year off, because prior to that, I think I was only ever at home in the last 20 years for between 6 and 8 weeks a year, just touring solidly, and suddenly to be at home and fix all those things and did up the garden, you know, growing vegetables and stuff. It's been fantastic.
Right,
you know?
Oh, because that's nice. A lot of performers have had a really difficult time.
So I kind of haven't missed it, but, you know, I'm back performing now, and I slip into those shoes very easily and enjoy it. And there's work planned for the next few months, and in all honesty, I'd like to see... I'm a bit disappointed that Eric the Fred wasn't seen more, I think, because I think it's my finest piece, and I think it kind of... It's a reinvention of a particular kind of style of clowning that I can conjure up, you know, which is quite unique, I think. And I think more people should see something like that, and that might trigger me onto...
To other things.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, people, you know, can't talk about clowns without thinking about the sad clown concept. Do you have a bit of that, do you think?
No, not really. No, I don't. But I understand it, and I know its power. That's why, you know, someone like Beckett is so extraordinary, playing with those different emotions, really, which is quite... It doesn't really happen that much, and I'm surprised that the stand-up world has kind of excluded a lot of that. You know, what I'm trying to say is, like, in the early days of alternative comedy, which is what stand-up came out of, really, there was a lot more variety and a lot more interesting builds than there are now, with endless people with just a microphone and not...
Is that not a two-way thing, though? Because what I was going to ask you about is the audience as well. You know, I saw you over 30 years ago. Things have changed a lot in the world anyway. But we as an audience have changed as well. And perhaps people's threshold for excitement and for what is accepted as cutting edge, I suppose, is also different. And as a performer who kind of feeds off audiences, obviously, because all performers do, have you felt the change in that respect?
Yeah, I think. Not as au fait with theatre audiences as I'd like to be, because I'm mainly work in the cabaret world, and I work with Slava Snowshow quite a bit. That's and that's in big theatres, and it's a kind of very fixed and formulaic show, and good audiences love it. You know, it's a very well constructed piece. Yeah, the cabaret, well, the attention span seems to have really dropped off, that, you know, you can't... I mean, that's what I liked about Eric the Fred, because it's very slow and,
yes,
you know, you can take time to just hold a moment. You don't have to,
yes,
fill it with movement of words or, you know... It's quite a reflective piece, I thought,
yes,
which...
But you don't resent the two kind of the two extremes at all.
No.
I mean, you obviously you can be very fast, and as you proved in Eric the Fred, very, very slow as well. So you have the ability to cater for both needs, I suppose.
Yeah, no, it's nice to have the variation, really.
And talking about variation, you've travelled extensively around the world. Am I right in thinking that your performance is not particularly British, is more kind of European in a sense? Would you say that? And do you feel more comfortable with kind of continental audiences or...?
I'm not that particular about audiences. I don't differentiate them very much, no. I'm not clever enough to to understand the subtleties. You can have a good audience here on one night and the next night it can be mediocre they can be not satisfied and be miserable by the whole event. So, I mean, that can happen in the same venue. So, and I think it's the same around the world. You know, you have good nights and better nights.
Of course. It's just that I think I remember reading an interview once with Stephen Berkoff, the actor, who said that he kind of, you know, he's done a couple of Hollywood films, but also he said, you know, in England and in America, he sort of works to an extent to make money that would enable him to do his more kind of arty European style work in Europe, where he feels that his work is more appreciated and accepted. I think he said something along these lines.
Well, I think especially for him, because he worked quite a lot in the mime world, I think, didn't he? I mean, I know and respect him, but I haven't seen much of his work actually, but more as a film actor.
Yeah, Chris, it's been an absolute pleasure having you.
Oh, thank you.
And I look forward to seeing the next project.
Oh, thanks very much for having me, yeah.